heaven, on the way into the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. The weapon that fashion against him will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. Lord. The power of darkness comes in like a flood. The battle belongs to the Lord. He raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory.
Good morning, everyone. We are so appreciative that you have come and joined us to worship this morning and given of your time to be here. And we just want to wish everybody here an early happy Valentine's Day. We want to remind you that Brother Frank has a midweek Bible study that everyone is invited to attend. You've got two options. Actually, technically, you've got three. If you can't make it here to the church in person, he does upload his video to YouTube. So you can just go to our YouTube channel, watch that video, and you can join in with him on his Bible study. And then if you'd like, you can also join him here at the church on Wednesdays at 6 p.m., and he does an in-person discussion of the video on YouTube. So you can go out there, watch it ahead of time, and then if you're able, come up here and join him at the church. They'd love to have you. Also, we want to invite everybody to join us for the new sermon series that Brother Oscar is presenting on Balaam. This is going to be a very interesting series. I think you guys are all going to really enjoy it. And one reminder we have for you guys is that next Sunday, if you are a member of the church council, believe it or not, it's already church council time. So Sunday, February 20th, immediately following the church service, we will be meeting for church council. And we are going to have a special event for you guys immediately following the service on Sunday, February 27th. So that's the very last Sunday of this month. Immediately after the service, we are going to have a VBS preview for everybody. So we'll just have just a small little preview of the theme and what it's going to look like. And you're going to have the ability to sign up. I've already had some spots start filling up, people, so you got to get on this. You can't just sit around and wait. This is big time, so make sure that you join us, even if you can only join us for a few minutes. Just come and say hi and see what the theme is all about and see how you can pray, or if you'd like to get involved, how you can help. And we just appreciate, again, everyone joining us this morning as we turn it back over for our service.
And as Becky is going back up, Herbert said that he is looking forward to VBS and that he is going to be the one to cover all the music this year. For you that not aware, Herbert was a bass in my family coming up, and he said it's about time that everyone get to know that he's a bass and that if Miss Becca let him, he's going to cover all the music this year. So, Christy, you have someone to help you. Yeah. All right. Okay.
I'm telling you.
Okay. All right. Let us continue with our service. The song says, Jesus, your name. The nations will put their hope in his name. Because Jesus, your name is power. Your name is might. Break every stronghold. Your name is light.
Jesus, your name is power. Jesus, your name is might. Jesus, your name.
Please stand for the reading of God's Word. This morning, our scripture reading comes from the book of Numbers, the 22nd chapter, starting in verse 3. Would you read with me, please? Now Balak, son of Zippor, saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites, and Moab was terrified because there were so many people. Indeed, Moab was filled with dread because of the Israelites. You may be seated. Lord of hosts, you are the one that fills people's hearts with dread. You direct the minds and hearts of men to prosper in you or to suffer defeat at your hand. You are the one who will culminate history and when. We look forward to you ruling as King of Kings and Lord of Lords here on earth for a time of prosperity and peace and righteousness and justice here on earth. And we look forward to living with you eternally in heaven. In your almighty name, amen.
As we go into the stewardship part of our service today, our thought comes out of 1 Corinthians. There in the 9th chapter, beginning in verse 24, it says, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? So run in a way as to get the prize." In other words, what it's talking about is discipline. And we've seen that this past week with the Olympics. We have people that train for years and all years. It takes discipline to be to excel in a certain activity. And that's the same thing about being a Christian, because discipleship requires discipline. Faithful giving requires discipline, and we have to understand what that discipline involves. Well, it involves listening to God, doing what He tells us to do, practicing it daily. And what giving does, since you know we're talking about stewardship, it shows, it expresses our love for others. Because through our giving, we are able vicariously to reach out and touch the lives of so many people through our missionaries that normally we would not have the ability to do. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we have to come before you with our gifts and offerings and tithes and lay them at your feet. And we recognize that it's through this that not only are we obeying your command, but it is just the right thing to do, because It is through our love for you and your love for us that we're able to give. And we thank you, Lord, that you have given us this need in our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
If you are able to stand, let us stand as we go before the throne of our Lord Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, petitioning your throne of grace. Lord, we lift holy hands before you this morning, honoring you with praises. Lord, come sit a while with us right now as we prepare to hear your message. Be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today we are going to start a new series in its own Balaam. A lot of times when you hear messages on Balaam, it's one message and it just talks about one event in his life or why he did something. Well, we're going to spend several weeks looking at Balaam and all that has happened around him and why it has happened. Now, very few people study the book of Numbers. You know, Numbers is where Balaam's found. And I suspect even fewer people have even read the book of Numbers. And, you know, I believe the reason the book of Numbers is usually ignored is that people just think that these last three books of the Pentateuch, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, are boring. Now, let's face it. You know, there are some portions of the Pentateuch that, you know, you can't say it any other way, that they're boring. Yet that doesn't mean that they're irrelevant. In fact, one of the most fascinating stories in the Bible is found here in this book. Now, I'm talking about the story of Balaam. You know, Balaam is a diviner. You know, he was hired to curse Israel by the king of Moab. And the story of Balaam provides us with a case study of a false prophet who sought to curse Israel. But, you know, what we find out is that it ends up that he can only proclaim blessings upon God's people. And then when you read about Balaam arguing with his donkey, you know, how can you possibly not keep from laughing at that? You know, and best of all, the donkey wins. So, you know, this is what we're looking at. This is the man that we're going to be talking to, someone that speaks to animals. So, before we take up Balaam's story, I need to give you, I guess we would call it the lay of the land, a little background. And we're going to do a quick review of the book of Numbers. Now, if I were to go through it chapter by chapter, I mean verse by verse, or really chapter by chapter, we'd be here forever. Yes. Now, Numbers begins with the giving of the begins after the beginning after the giving of the law, while the Israelites are still located there at Mount Sinai. You know, as you begin reading, you'll see that the first few chapters talk about a census. You know, the people are numbered and looked at, and the tribes are given, and the arrangements around the tabernacle and where they're to be camped. Some new rules and laws are presented. But once all of this was accomplished, Numbers tells us the cloud lifted from above the tabernacle of the covenant of law. Now, what you have to remember is that the Israelites, God told them, or Moses told them, that, you know, as God leads us, that's that cloud in the daytime and a pillar of fire at night. So when that cloud lifted up, that was, you know, and a call to say, all right, we're going to move out. So once that cloud lifted, they began to move out to possess their promised land. Now, they're walking around, they're in the desert, and when they get to Kadesh Barnea in the wilderness of Paran, everybody knows where that is, but this Kadesh Barnea, in Numbers, in the first part, it doesn't mention that name. It just says in the wilderness of Paran. But when you get to the back part of Numbers, it'll give you a name. That's about the same location as Petra. You know, it's in Jordan. But when they got there, you know, they're close to the promised land. So 12 men are sent out, one representing each tribe, to spy out the land, because they're getting ready to go in and possess it. But when the men return, they had nothing but praise about just how bountiful the land was. Yet, 10 of them sort of were doubtful. They were fearful of the Canaanites who lived there. And those 10 men, with their doubts, were enough to cast doubts on the rest of Israel being able to conquer the land. So they said, no, we're not going over there. There's some bad people. And because of this, because the Israelites rebelled against God and refused to enter the promised land, you know, he was going to defeat them for them, but they didn't fully understand that. This led to God's judgment upon all those who had originally been delivered out of Egyptian bondage. That's that first generation. So, because God got a little upset with them, he says, well, let's take a walk. And for 40 years, they walked around the wildernesses there. And virtually, you know, after 40 years, virtually all died. And that during that wandering period, along with the setting down of some more laws. All of this is described in chapters 15 through 19. And beginning in chapter 20 and onward, the book of Numbers really deals with the second generation. You know, the first ones died off. You know, when you get into 20 and down, the people are preparing to enter and possess the land of Canaan a second time. And it's in this section of Numbers that we find the story of Balaam. But that's a little, you know, we're not getting there yet. Now, along the way, as we read through Numbers, the Israelites come to the wilderness of Zin. Now, this is the same wilderness that they entered when they came out of Egypt after they crossed the Red Sea. And while they was there, Miriam died. Then, since there was no water, you know, that's why it's called a wilderness. You know, it's a desert. The people began to grumble. So Moses, feeling bad for these poor people, intercedes with God. You know, we need some water. And God does what he does in his mercy. He instructs Moses. He says, just go over there, tell that rock, just speak nicely to it, pet it. And by this means, water will be provided for the people to drink. But Moses, and, you know, we're sort of like Moses at times, he's just exasperated with these stiff-necked people that are constantly on his back about some problem. So he goes up there and he says, I'm going to show them. And he takes his stick and he just slams it down on that rock. And it was that act of irreverence that caused him to be forbidden to enter the promised land. Now, about this same time, God tells Moses that it's time for Aaron to be gathered up to his people. Now, doesn't that sound nice? In other words, God tells Moses, it's time for Aaron to die. You know, we're going to get rid of him. Then in the sight of all the congregation, Moses, Aaron and Eleazar ascends Mount Hor, where Moses removed Aaron's priestly garments and placed them on Aaron's son, that's Eleazar. And then Aaron dies. Now remember, we're still these Aaron and Miriam, you know, they're still part of that first generation. The only one left is Moses at this time. But all of these events that are taking place signal an important chapter in Israel's history, a chapter which began with the Exodus and concluded with the death of that generation who failed to trust and obey God. Then, after the Israelites had mourned for 30 days for Aaron's death, they returned to their journey. You know, they still hadn't made it to the promised land yet. But when the Canaanite, the king of Arad, heard that the Israelites were approaching, for no reason at all, he attacks them. And then in return, you know, God gave this king and his people into the hands of the Israelites. In other words, God provided the victory here. Israel is building up their self-esteem. They utterly destroy King Arad and his people. Now, the Israelites weren't looking for a fight. Okay, it just seems to come to them. So They sought to bypass Edom, and they decided to travel along the coast of the Red Sea. It's a little bit out of the way, but this took too long. And so the people, again, became impatient and began to grumble. Because of this attitude, God sent fiery serpents upon them as divine judgment, killing so many that Moses could just had so much empathy for his people that he interceded with God. Why, God? Why are you doing this? So God, and remember, God's a God of mercy, instructed Moses to make a bronze serpent and place it on a pole. And then, as the Bible tells us, then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. After that, after the people had been punished sufficiently, Israel made its way to Pisgah. You know, all of this is coming into where we're going to be studying Balaam. This is just a background. These are the first 21 chapters of Numbers. But they come to Pisgah. Now, Pisgah is located on a ridge near the top of Mount Nebo. And from there, you can look out and see a panoramic view of the Promised Land. Now, just as an aside, you know, this is also where Moses is going to go up and die a little later on. But from here, in order to continue their journey to the Promised Land, the Israelites needed to pass through the land of the Amorites. And so they just didn't boldly go where no man had gone before. They asked Sheon, the king of the Amorites, for permission to pass. You know, they said, may we pass through your land? And he said, no. You know, just being obstinate, no. And not only did he refuse, he assembled an army and began to wage war against the Israelites. And not really or fully appreciating this gesture, the Israelites not only prevailed and took possession of his land, but they defeated and dispossessed all the rest of the Amorites who lived there. So, you know, they're still on their way. And by going the way of Bashan, the Israelites encountered Og, the king of Bashan, who also came out to fight them. These were some people with an attitude. And like Sheon, Og was defeated, and the Israelites took his land too. Now, you know, all of this is building up their self-esteem, where they will know that they can go across. No more 10 men to tell them, no, we're not, you know, good enough. So in Numbers 22 to 1-3, we're entering in to the time of Balaam. It says, then the Israelites traveled to the plains of Moab and camped along the Jordan across from Jericho. That's the Promised Land. You know, it's just right across the river. Now Balak, son of Zippor, saw that what all Israel had done to the Amorites. And Moab was terrified because there were so many people. Indeed, Moab was filled with dread because of the Israelites. Now, it's not too difficult to understand why Balak felt threatened, you know, as the Israelites approached. There were millions of them. And he had heard of Israel's victory over anyone that opposed them. You know, what a sight it would have been. Go to bed one night, you know, all fat, dumb, and happy, and then get up the next morning, look out your window, and see an innumerable host of Israelites camped right outside your house. In fact, you know, that's why we're told the Moabites were filled with dread. Now, I just don't understand why they were so frightened. You know, there was no need for them to fear for their lives, since the Moabites were the offspring of Lot. And God had specifically told the Israelites, do not hurt the Moabites. You know, they're okay. You just leave them alone. And the Moabites, they weren't stupid. They would have known, you know, their lineage, because they understood that they did have a special privilege from God, since they were descendants of Lot. Now, as we look more closely at the words of verse 4, this isn't why Balak feared these Israelites. You know, listen to what he told the Midianites when he went over to get their help. In Numbers 22:4, it says, the Moabites said to the elders of Midian, this horde is going to lick up everything around us as an ox licks up the grass of the field. You know, this, what you have to understand is that their fears were economic. You know, it's just like here in our country. You have the people raising cattle with these open fields, and then what happens? Sheep herders come in. What do sheep do? They eat the grass down to the dirt. There's nothing left for cattle to eat. They, you know, that was economic. When Balak called attention to the large number of Israelites approaching, he didn't mention anything about war or slaughter. He only spoke of the Israelites coming near to them, settling down alongside them. He's concerned that the Israelites would consume all the natural resources of the land, leaving nothing for his people. And because of this, the Moabites feared the presence of the Israelites so much that they were willing to hire what's known as a diviner to put a curse on them, you know, to make them just go away. And that's where we come into Numbers 22, the last part of 4 through 6. So Balak, son of Zippor, who was king of Moab at that time, sent messengers to summon Balaam, son of Beor, who was at Pethor near the Euphrates River in his native land. Balak said, a people has come out of Egypt. They cover the face of the land and have settled next to me. Now come and put a curse on these people because they are too powerful for me. Perhaps then I will be able to defeat them and drive them out of the land. For I know that whoever you bless is blessed, and whoever you curse is cursed. You know, there, Balak's aim was to somehow weaken this great nation by cursing them, thus giving the Moabites an advantage so they could drive them out of the land. Otherwise, they couldn't do it. They've heard what happened to the others that tried that. Now, you're probably thinking there's strength in numbers, or maybe just wanting to spread out the cost of hiring a consultant like Balaam. That's why the Moabites formed an alliance with the Midianites. Now, the Midianites, you have to understand, everybody's related to everybody. The Midianites were somehow related to the Israelites in a backhanded fashion. Midian was one of the sons of Abraham through Keturah. You know, that's in Genesis 25. Also, when Moses fled from Egypt, where did he go? He settled in the land of Midian, where he married the daughter of a Midianite priest. You know, that was Jethro. Yet the Moabites and the Midianites conspired together to recruit a man who had connections with the spiritual underworld, a man they believed that could put a curse on the Israelites. Now, just as an aside here, Balaam's name means devour. And if some linguists say it means devourer of the people. And Balak's name means devastator. Devastator and devourer were joining forces to block Israel's passage into the promised land. That's what we see at this time. Now, no doubt at that time frame, there were diviners were plentiful. But there seemed to be one man who was tops in his field. His name, Balaam. He was from Pethor, a city located along the Euphrates River. Now, Pethor was not far from the great city of Mari. Everybody's heard of Mari, M-A-R-I. It was discovered in 1933 along the Euphrates Valley. And when Mari was discovered, archaeologists found a vast number of cuneiform tablets which revealed the existence of a cult of prophets and seers whose activities resembled those of Balaam. Pethor, located on the banks of the Euphrates River, was only about 12 miles south of Carchemish. And Carchemish is a place where several key historical battles took place. Also, Pethor was about 370 miles from the plains of Moab, where Balak was. You know, it would have taken about 20 to 25 days to get there. And as you read the story, as we read the story, there were four journeys that were made. So that's at least 90 days, you know, that 3 months almost. And the distance that was between Pethor and Moab serves another purpose. Now, this is speculation on my part, but it's possible that Balak wanted a diviner who lived a good distance from Moab so he would be ignorant of the Israelites' successes. Now, Balaam knows something of the religion of the Israelites because he frequently refers to their God as Yahweh. Nevertheless, it seems he's not well informed about the nation itself, since he has to be told that Israel had been blessed by Yahweh. Now, Balaam lived just far enough from Canaan to be unaware of the factors that were vital to his decision regarding Balak's offer. You know, this is the thing. A lot of times we make decisions based on false information or not enough information. Well, here, this is what happened to Balaam. Now, there's many reasons why we can confidently conclude that Balaam wasn't a true prophet or even a true believer in God. But for the moment, let's just say that Balaam was a well-known diviner with a reputation for effectively cursing nations. You know, I'm not saying that he was a complete fraud and that his curses had no effect on others. You know, he was well-known. He had to be good. His reputation and his name indicate otherwise. And if his cursings were in vain, why did God forbid him to curse Israel? You know, I believe that his powers came from below. You know, Think about that. He was connected, okay, but not to the God of Israel. And Balak's message to Balaam is very informative. In verses 5-6, Balak said, "A people has come out of Egypt. They cover the face of the land and have settled next to me. Now come and put a curse on these people, because they are too powerful for me. Perhaps then I will be able to defeat them and drive them out of the land. For I know that whoever you bless is blessed, and whoever you curse is cursed." Now, Balak doesn't it bother to inform Balaam how the Israelites managed to come out of Egypt. You know, a little bit of information that probably would have helped. He doesn't mention the covenant God made with Abraham, nor does he bother to tell Balaam that the Israelites had destroyed anybody that opposed them on the way. But what he does tell him is, you know, we're outnumbered. And so he reveals his plan to defeat the Israelites, to be able to drive them out of his land. And when Balak says to Balaam, "For I know that whoever you bless is blessed, and whoever you cursed is cursed," when you read that, it brings to mind the words of God in the Abrahamic covenant. But we have to remember that it's neither Balak nor Balaam who bestows blessings or cursings on nations. It's God who blesses and curses. Now, the only question is, will the Moabites and the Midianites be blessed or cursed? Yeah, you'll have to turn in next week for that. But this is going to be determined by their response to the nation Israel. Those, you know, remember, those who bless Israel will be blessed. Those who curse Israel will be cursed. And in light of the Abrahamic covenant, we see that Balak's plan to curse Israel is just destined to bring a curse upon him and the Moabite nation. We have to remember that it's never more dangerous or foolish to be for what God is against and against what God is for. You know, we tend to forget that at times. Balaam was seeking to curse those whom God had blessed. You know, just think of the logic. That made Balaam against those whom God was for. And in so doing, Balaam found God to be his adversary, not Israel. You know, how much better is it for us today to have God as our advocate? As Paul puts it, "What then shall we say about these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?" You know, those who would have God as their adversary are those who must one day bow before him as Lord of all. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you today looking at this story of Balaam, looking to see what we can pull out of this story that will help us to understand how powerful you are. And Lord, we just lift your name in glory, knowing that you are the Lord of all, that we can just rest in peace, knowing that you are in control. And we come to you so like begging that you would help us fully understand just how great you really are, and that we can pass this on to others that we meet, that we can witness to them and tell them these stories that will amplify your true greatness. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.